Nikola Tesla was the inventor of the Tesla coil and contributed to many breakthroughs in radio and wireless technology. He invented the induction motor, precursor of the turbine fairy, and was responsible for the discovery of teleportation, as seen in the documentary The Prestige. Many consider him foundational to the modern grid, and he became a rich man when Westinghouse bought the patent for his induction motor for $60,000. And money was only a part of the deal. He was also due to receive $2.50 on every horsepower of capacity that used his AC motor. This would have amounted to $100 million in Tesla's lifetime. But then the war of currents began, a battle between Westinghouse and Edison to determine the future of the grid. Edison used every dirty trick in the book, from the public electrocution of stray dogs to lobbying for AC current in executions. And since Edison was first to market, he owned most of the patents for electricity transmission. He filed lawsuit after lawsuit to weaken Westinghouse's resolve. But AC had the technological advantage, and people within General Electric knew this. So they began marginalizing Edison. And in 1896, J.P. Morgan told the two to stop fighting and figure out a patent-sharing arrangement. Edison finally gave up and sold his stock in General Electric. But Westinghouse was already losing money on his AC systems to remain competitive. And the prolonged legal battle with Edison meant his company was in serious trouble. Things could have gotten much worse, but Tesla came to his old boss's aid. Under no obligation to do so, he agreed to forego millions in royalties and tore up the contract. This relieved the burden on Westinghouse, and it allowed him to build out the grid system based on AC. But Tesla was not one to rest on his laurels. One of his most ambitious projects was yet to come. While AC was superior to DC, both needed kilometers of wires for transmission. He believed that he could send power without wires to any part of the world. J.P. Morgan gave Tesla $150,000 to explore this idea. Wireless transmission towers that would carry electricity and information, becoming the Earth's nervous system. Work on the Wardenclyffe Tower began in 1898, and Tesla was able to light up lamps a few hundred feet away, but he was not able to produce any results that validated his theories. J.P. Morgan ran out of patience and the project ran out of money. Even Tesla's remarkable genius could not crack this puzzle. And when he died in 1943, in one of the last DC-powered hotels in America, it seemed that his dream died with him. Whatever power we make here on Earth has unavoidable environmental costs associated with it. With solar power, for example, we need to give up vast tracts of land. 1 megawatt of installed solar capacity needs 4 acres of land. To generate enough power for the whole world, you'd need more land than the whole of the United Kingdom. And because the sun doesn't always shine, you'll only get this power around a third of the time on average. To make everything worse, this is also unreliable. You don't know when you're going to get the power. A passing cloud could ruin your day. And if you have monsoons for 2 months, that's a lot of time when your panels aren't producing electricity. So we need to install massive amounts of storage alongside the solar panels to account for that. But it's free energy from the sun, and us humans can't really resist free stuff. We can resolve all of these problems by putting solar panels on the moon, no ecosystems to damage, and access to all the land we'll ever need. Since there is no weather system on the moon, you don't need to add glass and aluminium to protect the panels from the elements. Sunlight also loses 21% of usable energy while passing through the atmosphere. The moon has no atmosphere to speak of, so you get all of the radiations. If we build a ring around the moon, at least half of it will always be illuminated by sunlight. Steady power, reliable as a coal power plant, while having no carbon or environmental footprint, available all the time. The ideal energy source. Sending stuff to the moon is quite difficult. Transporting enough solar panels to cover all our energy needs would be expensive, like 200 times the GDP of the world expensive. If you go to investors quoting prices in multiples of GDPs, they're first going to laugh and then throw you out the window. So let's find a better way, okay? This paper proposes a much more elegant approach. all we need to do is send a 150 kg crawler to the moon. Once it lands, it will unfurl its solar collectors and begin melting the surface of the moon. The melted regolith will form a smooth glassy layer on which the crawler can create solar cells. See, a solar cell is essentially a sandwich made from thin layers of silicon. We know how to make layers of silicon, and over the years we've become exceedingly good at it. Since the moon has no atmosphere, you can use vacuum deposition to make these cells. The crawler will move along at 1 meter per hour, pushing aside moon rocks and coating the lunar surface with solar cells. Sounds pretty good. So how much of the moon's surface would it need to cover to provide for all our energy needs? About 11,000 square kilometers. So to finish the task, the crawler will take about 1.2 million years, which is not so bad. Oh, and I kind of forgot something important. This doesn't take into account that the solar cells we'll be making won't exactly be of the highest quality. While commercial solar cells work at 20% efficiency, these will be around 5%. So it's more like 20 million years. But we're not going to give up that easy. Any task becomes easier when you break it up into smaller pieces. So we'll do it in phases, just like the moon. Let's assume it costs $40 million to make a crawler and $15,000 per kg to get stuff to the moon. In the first 10 years, we'll continue sending more crawlers, two every year, which will help accelerate the process of covering the moon with solar panels. 5 years in, we can send some astronauts to begin the process of setting up a permanent moon base near the South Pole. There's water there, and from water, you can get both hydrogen for propulsion as well as oxygen for breathing. And guess what? You can drink it too. The human settlement can run on nuclear power or their own solar panels. But the crawlers will also start setting up an electrical link to the lunar ring for the second phase. A human presence will mean faster response to issues, as well as teaching us all the challenges of living on the moon. In the second era, we'll begin assembling rover factories on the moon, process the lunar regolith to extract all the raw materials we require for the rovers. The factories will begin churning out 12 crawlers a year each. We'll still have to send some stuff like microchips and sensors from Earth, but it'll bring our launch costs down drastically. The human settlement will start sourcing all its water from the moon's South Pole, and farms will start producing food round the clock. We'll also start the first power transmission tests using microwave antennas. The third stage involves a mega factory, something resembling the scale of Gigafactory 3, which will produce 250,000 Teslas a year. We will be a little more cautious, with our version making 150,000 crawlers a year. This allows us to significantly ramp up our capacity. At this point, we can even build additional habitats to welcome manned moon missions from different countries, as well as private organizations. We'll begin large-scale transmission of electricity here. This will need construction of receiving stations on Earth, but revenues should start flowing in. The fourth stage begins with the construction of another mega factory. And with the completion of more ground stations, we'll start putting relay satellites into orbit that can redirect power to any part of the world. In the fifth and final stage, we go into steady state. A facility is set up to recycle most of the crawlers, except a reserve capacity, to compensate for micrometeorite impacts and the like. And also to generate additional capacity, since we'll surely need it. The recycled materials can be sold to other corporations that want to establish moon operations, or maybe shot off to Mars to help kickstart a colony. Okay, so we've said we'll transmit power to Earth, but haven't really gone into any detail. Here's the thing. We'll still need around 100,000 square kilometers for the Rectenna arrays. That's half of what we would have required for solar panels on Earth. But it's still a lot. But look at the upside. They can be made anywhere, not just in places that get lots of sun. And you don't have to mess around with grid-scale storage or gas turbines to compensate for downtime. The Earth still does rotate, but those relay satellites will be able to beam the power wherever required. It'll take us much further to being a space-faring civilization. The crawlers are basically primitive versions of our very first Dyson swarm. Phew! All done! We've powered the entire world, defeated climate change, and people's elbowed the forces of chaos. And the robot army we left on the moon can manufacture any capacity we need in the future too. Lunar regolith might be a source of materials, but it is really destructive to machines. And while having no atmosphere allows the sun's rays to pass through unhindered, that's not totally good news. That means there's all manner of nasty radiation that the crawlers and astronauts will have to deal with. Not to mention the crawlers will have to contend with extreme temperature variations between night and day. Lunar eclipses can put a wrench into things twice a year, but we can deal with those with time-honored traditions. Running around, screaming in terror and despair, until the power comes back on. But is it safe? Could a rogue astronaut turn it into a weapon and cook entire cities? Well, certain safety measures would be built in. For example, you can have a low-power handshake between the transmitter and receiver before any power is delivered. In any case, the power over the Rectenna array will not be higher than a fourth of sunlight. A gentle warming would be all you'd feel if you walked over there. But just to be extra safe, some proposals call for the receiver arrays to be located in deserts and oceans. So roasted pigeons will not be falling out of the sky anytime soon. Just to clarify, that's a good thing. As brilliant as he was, Tesla's wireless transmission probably would not have succeeded as he had conceived it. But in the years since, we have uncovered secret after secret to the point where we can turn our long-suffering satellite into a power plant. Should we do it? Yeah, why not? As long as we take a roundabout to make sure old rebel leaders aren't still living there. It should be safe. I don't think this is what leads us to cracking the moon in two. But let's be honest. The kind of international cooperation this requires is not likely in our lifetimes. Only if the finances really work out will there be any interest. But still, having so much power on the moon would allow us to have a proper moon presence, permanent settlements, low-cost launch sites for exploring the solar system, maybe large telescopes that don't need to peer through several kilometers of air. Maybe we can even mine some of that helium-3 that the Chinese are so keen on. All I'm saying is, let's at least consider it. So like the video and jump into the comments to see what people are talking about. I'll see you really soon. Bye.